What I've been wondering is, in the month or so that Breakshot has been out in the world, have you heard from your brothers or your sister or any of your old friends complaining that you got stuff wrong?
No, I haven't. I haven't heard from them at all.
Well, we'll count that as a blessing.
I did. I wrote them all and gave them a heads up that this thing was coming out and that to forgive me any that it was going to be my version of what I remembered, but that it might not particularly jive with what they remembered. But nonetheless, it's a heads up. Here it comes.
Well, we'll assume that their silence is admiration, stunned admiration.
No, I think they're cool with it. You know, okay. I think everything is fine. Yeah, yeah.
And between going back into your first 21 years for Breakshot and working on this album, which is songs you heard and loved as a kid in your parents' house, mm-hmm. have you been sort of living in the past? Have you been having dreams about your third grade teacher or anything?
You know. I don't remember my dreams very well, you know, but I have had some good dreams recently, and maybe it stirred some things up. The songs that I've recorded for the American Standard album for Fantasy Records, it's coming out day after tomorrow. Friday, day after tomorrow. Yeah. Oh. That's good.
This is all the stuff I was supposed to say in the intro.
Oh, it was. Oh. Right. That's Friday the 28th. That's good. And I think it's also I noticed that it's on a waxing moon, which is auspicious. They say that's good. Yeah.
Well, now we know. We know how you're planning your record releases.
That's it.
You know. By the way, it occurred to me about half an hour ago that. Maybe this week or last week is the 50th anniversary of the release of Sweet Baby James. How does that make you feel?
I'm sure there is an actual date when Warner Brothers released it, so yeah.
It was February of 1970.
Okay.
So
that's got to be. That's 50 years.
You know, that is the... it's worked out well. Yeah. That is the that's where Breakshot ends.
That's right.
Where you've finished recording Sweet Baby James. It hasn't come out yet, and your life is about to change. And I wonder if, to take this 1 hour past where Breakshot ends, in the aftermath of that, of having enormous success, do you think it changed the way you wrote? Because Sweet Baby James and Fire and Rain and Country Road and Carolina in My Mind and Something in the Way She Moves were all written before people knew your name. So when you suddenly were out in the world, did it sort of change the cards around?
You know, I guess it did a little bit. It certainly changed my take on things. Who I was addressing the songs to originally was like a very abstract thing. And then when you actually have an audience, you become aware of actually who's listening and what they might think of it. And it changes things a little bit. But that's something that changes over time anyway, you know, as time goes on, and you learn to do it better. You learn to write, you learn the craft of it, sort of. The sort of urgency and the pressure behind getting this stuff out in public diminishes and wanes a little bit, but the thing that takes its place is sort of an ability, a capacity to do it. But it did. It did change. Going from being a very private person, and I think that can be said of anyone who, any instrumentalist, particularly people who invent their own style, they have to have spent a huge amount of time by themselves. You can't do it and be the most popular guy in high school. You know, you can't. That's not going to happen. So you go from almost an alienated person to being you become the product. You know, and in my case, particularly with such personal material that I write about, such self-centered kind of songs, it really was. A jarring experience, but it was for so many of my contemporaries too, and some of them didn't survive it.
Yeah, some of them didn't survive it, and I would have to imagine that there must be a tendency to say, I've actually heard Pete Townsend say this, that you go, oh, so you want to know all about me? Well, how about this? Let me tell you the worst thing about myself.
Oh, absolutely. What, you know, you basically sort of throw anything out there that might be of any use or interest, and you notice what people pick up on and what they tend to elaborate and what they, you know, what doesn't interest them at all. So, yeah, you do. I think he's really right about that. And that comes from a certain insecurity that you can't believe that they're showing this kind of interest in you know, your, you know, here too, pretty uninteresting life.
Well, you know, James, I believe most of what you say, but I don't think you can say you had an uninteresting life.
Well, I meant uninteresting in terms of nobody really,
nobody cared.
Yeah,
nobody cared. When, you know, you made that incredible first album for Apple when you were 19, and it had Something in the Way She Moves, it had Carolina in My Mind, it had Rainy Day Man, and you must have felt like, I've made it. I'm here with the Beatles. I'm in London. When that album did not hit, and when you found yourself out of a deal, did you feel like, now I got to go back to school? I had my chance and it's over?
Well, no. I knew I wasn't going back to school because I'd spent my college dough. You know, I'd spent it mostly on psychiatric hospitals, on McLean Hospital, which I recommend. wholeheartedly, in Belmont, Massachusetts, just outside of Cambridge. I think it's like the MGH psychiatric hospital, so it's a good one. But it's expensive, and even in those days, it pretty much in a year's time it ate up an entire college education worth of dough. So I wasn't going back to school, but I had. You know, I'd been a sort of serious, committed musician for the year that I spent here, 66 to 67, here in Manhattan.
In this neighborhood.
In this, it might have been in this neighborhood, some of it, yeah. Yeah. How far from here is McDougal and Third?
Just over there.
Is it really?
We could run over there and be back.
You mean Sixth Avenue is just over there?
Sure. Yes. I mean, we go down Bleecker Street, we hit Washington Square, we hit Sixth Avenue.
Yep. That's it.
You're home.
Yeah. I spent a lot of time at, I had some friends whose parents taught it at NYU, and I think they were quartered somewhere around this neighborhood.
No doubt about it. But you were committed to music at that point.
Right. So you were asking what had happened after sort of signing to the Beatles and how exciting that was and getting an album out and then seeing it do sort of, well, critically, but sort of modestly in sales. But, you know, I had no idea what, I knew what the Beatles sold, but I didn't have that expectation, you know. So record sales was sort of it wasn't really what I was thinking about. And mostly I was thinking about, well, where are we going to make our next record? But,
right.
Yeah. But, you know, I had a lot of other things on my mind, too, when I came back to the States. And Peter Asher called me up and said, Alan Klein has taken over Apple Records and, you know, this place is finished. So we've got to find a, he said, I propose coming to the States. Once I get myself set up with a job, I'll manage you and produce a second record and we'll find a label. And so I said, yeah, that sounds good. I called Paul McCartney and asked his opinion of whether he thought Peter would be a good manager, and he allowed us, yeah, how he would be, you know.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Well, they had been roommates, so yeah. He was obligated to say that.
Sorry.
But, and I should say for anyone who doesn't know that Peter Asher, Peter and Gordon, was your connection in London who, just by a stroke of luck, turned out to be the new talent scout at Apple Records. You were just calling him to see if he knew of any pub gigs, right?
I was calling him. I had made a demo tape encouraged by some friends that I'd met in London, from really lovely people. And I was shopping this demo around. And my old partner and fellow musician and bandmate Danny Korchmar, Cooch, he had done a U.S. tour with Peter and Gordon. That was the duo that Peter Asher was first known for. And Peter and Gordon had toured the States. Cooch had been at the band that backed him up. So I had a number for Cooch. I called him up from England. I said, have you got a number for that guy, Peter Asher? He said, I've got a number. I don't know if it still works, but here it is. And so I called him up and I said, you know, Danny gave me your number and I've got some songs and I've made a demo and I wonder if you know anyone I could play it for. And Peter said, yeah, you can play it for me. Come on over. So I did. I went over and I played him the tape and he gave me guitar and I played a few other tunes. And he said, let's go over to Apple Records tomorrow and see if we can play this stuff for a Beatle. And that it was really that. You know.
He said, man, what an easy business.
Yeah, it was. Yeah. Okay, check that one off.
So having done that, when you and Peter, and great credit to Peter, he got you that new deal with Warner Brothers. You went out to California to make Sweet Baby James. And did you and Peter talk about, okay, here's what we're going to do different than what we did in the first album? Nope.
Not really. I think the main difference was that I had access to Cooch, Danny Korchmar,
yeah,
who had been working. He had gone out to the West Coast to work with Carole King, who had also come from New York and had gone out to Los Angeles. And the idea was that, Cooch was working with Carole, and she was working up her own songs with a group called Writer. Mm-hmm. Trying, you know, experimenting herself with the idea of recording her songs her own self rather than the fabulous sort of songwriter for hire that she sort of Tin Pan Alley type songwriter that she had been. The main difference was that I was back with Cooch. I already had the experience of making one album, so did Peter. I had access to some really great players,
yeah,
not, which isn't to make denigrate or take away from the players that worked on the first album, but we were sort of I was completely out of my depth in London. We put advertisements in a couple of papers, one called the New Musical Express, another one called Melody Maker. These were trade papers in England at the time, and we started holding auditions, and that's how we got the bass player and the keyboard player that worked with me on the James Taylor, the first eponymous record on Apple. Yeah.
You know, something in the way she moves, as you say in Breakshot, you wrote when you were a teenager for a girl you were dating, that became the first song you played for Peter Asher, that became the song you played for Harrison and McCartney.
That's right.
I mean, that's an amazing song for a kid to have written, and a song that you can still sing today, and it sounds, you know, it's a song that sounds just as appropriate coming out of a grown man as it did, I assume, out of a 16-year-old kid.
Yeah. Yeah, well, you know, I really don't know how to do anything else, but it did, you know, it's sort of, you know, it's that old, if it works, don't fix it thing,
right,
you know,
right.
If you do something that is successful early on, there's a real tendency to keep at it, you know, and so I have, 50 years now.
Yeah. 50 years of success. Yeah. Now,
let's hear it for success.
you know, one of the big themes in Breakshot, one of the things you talk about a lot, is your relationship with your father and all the ways that, for better and worse, informed your life and your writing. And you tell the story about when you were here in the village, when you were a teenager, and you were strung out, and your dad came and sort of rescued you. He drove up from Carolina, and he put you in a car, and he brought you home. And something I had never heard before was what you said was what he told you about the Taylors and opiates. And I thought that was kind of fascinating. Would you?
Yeah. Well, it's all in the memoir, but Yeah, he told me that, you know, my dad came from a family, I'm not sure what they did before the Civil War in Morganton, North Carolina, but pretty much after the Civil War, they were all doctors and occasionally a lawyer. And they actually, the family owned a sanitarium. I think a lot of, you know, this isn't the first opiate epidemic that we've had in this country. We've had them before. And after the Civil War was a really big one. And I wouldn't be surprised if the family, if that sanitarium treated a number of addicts. But at any rate, his uncle, who essentially raised him, when my father decided to be pre-med at the University of North Carolina and then later went up to Harvard to medical school, his uncle told him, "Now listen, Ike, stay away from opiates, don't touch an opiate. It's poison to the tailors."
Poison to the tailors.
Yeah, he said, "You'll touch it and, you know, just if you pick it up, you'll never put it down."
So, wow.
And he did. He told me that. So yeah, that was sort of the lesson on the way home. It took me a while to get that lesson.
Well, your dad had a very complicated life. His mother had died giving him birth. His father had sort of couldn't deal with it and put him aside. And he grew up, as you said, In Breakshot, he grew up sort of feeling out of place, that he was in a state of original sin and had to always prove himself. What I wonder, again, going past the end of Breakshot, is when you and he were older, when you were 40 or something and you had all this experience in the world, were you able to talk about it with him sort of objectively? Was he able to sort of fill you in on what he had gone through or what he had felt or didn't feel?
You mean during that time when he came to pick me up and gave me a ride?
No, not
home,
just or, that, but yeah. But his whole background, and maybe, I mean, you say something very provocative in the story. You say that it always seems strange to you that someone who was an academic, who was the dean of a university, who was had his medical degree from Harvard, didn't even ask any of his kids why none of them wanted to go to college. Right. And I just wondered if later you and he talked about this stuff.
No. I don't think we really ever did. It just sort of, I never did ask him what he felt about that. It's sort of, in a million other ways, just living our lives together, we sort of, you know, we covered it without ever talking about it in a way, the way these things happen. So, I think it's true that he, what you say that he was felt that his position in the lifeboat of his family was conditional, and that his performance was he wasn't guaranteed anything. The family connection was tenuous, and his he had to prove himself and perform well in order to have a life.
I don't know what folks know and don't know. Maybe you should just explain why you called the project Breakshot, what that means.
Well, I was walking in the woods and that it came to me. I was there was a period of time in the mid-60s when my family, which had seemed to be on track, very well run family, an educated middle class family with enough money to take a vacation in the summertime and take a trip to Europe, send the kids to camp, we all of a sudden in the mid 60s just flew apart. And that reminded me of a break shot in pool where you rack up the balls and they're all in their little pyramid there in the middle of the table, and you just send the cue ball into them and they disperse randomly and chaotically. But that's what seemed to to happen to us in the mid-60s. And I don't think that by any means it's a unique story. I think there are many family stories like it.
I think in the late 60s and early 70s, that was happening all over the place.
Yeah,
I think that's one of the reasons that your records hit people so hard, was because whether the specifics were the same or not, it was articulating something that a lot of people were feeling. Which reminds me of something, I don't know if I've ever asked you this, and I don't know if there's an answer to it, but bear with me. It always seemed interesting to me that Fire and Rain and Bridge Over Troubled Water and Let It Be all came out sort of in the same 5 or 6 weeks, and they were all sort of recovery hymns. They were sort of, well, you've said hymns for agnostics. There was hymns without gods in them.
Right.
It just felt like there was something in the air that was very different from 1969 to 1970, and that people were just kind of trying to get out of the line of fire to some degree.
Yeah, I guess, you know, there's always a place at any time for all different kinds of songs, but certainly for ones that are kind of, I don't know, palliative or therapeutic or comforting or just you know, that acknowledge what's going on, you know, the difficulty of life or the, you know, the our sensibilities and sensitivities. But yes, perhaps at that time, you know, I think that it was a unique time. I think the demographic bulge, the boomer generation was all arriving at the age of 21, basically in a sort of a 7-year period. So it was a huge proportion of the population, and it had a real identity, and part of that identity was distinguishing itself, as sort of separating itself from the generation that had come before, from their parents. And really a sense that we really could reinvent the way America lived, the world lived. You know, we felt it felt like a movement. And of course there were movements. There was the anti-war movement, there was the civil rights movement, which was, you know, an amazing element there. There was the threat of nuclear annihilation. The draft was still on, you know. The assassinations of the Kennedys and Dr. King, those were, you know, it's like there was a set of things that were really, you know, in the beginning of the environmental movement, in the sense that, you know, Mother Nature on the run in the 1970s, as Neil says. You know, it was there was this handful of things that was really motivating people to change and to find a different way, and we spoke to ourselves and each other through the music. It was musically and you know, there's never really been a time like it, and it very much informs what music is today as well. It's sort of it was an amazingly creative time. It was.
Yes, and it was a creative time in rock music, in soul music, in jazz, in country. I mean, it was, and in film, in painting. It was sort of like there was something in the air, as they say. Although I can hear my kids over there going, you know, okay, boomer.
Yeah, that's right. it was a distinguished thing. You know, it really felt like a generation.
Yeah, and it was, as we have ridden out for 50 years since. When we were, I thought, when we were done with Breakshot, and we were having dinner up at your place, and you started telling the story of your car accident in London, which caused us to have to go back in and open up the recording studio and put it in, because it was just too good to leave out. And I'm going to indulge me here. Will you tell that story to these folks?
Oh, man.
how many of you folks have heard Breakshot? So just think of this as you like the album, now you're going to the concert.
Unless there's a bunch of one-handed people out there, I don't. About a third, I'd say. Yeah, I had a car in London. I had an English Ford, Cortina, and it was my heart's delight, and I drove it everywhere. The traffic in London was you know, it was negligible in 1968. And one morning, I was driving up behind a street in southwest London, but actually behind Knightsbridge in Kensington, and I was just accelerating up the street, and I think I was going from second to third, going faster than I should, and I was passing a box truck that was on my right, large lorry, and a guy jumped out from behind the truck. There was no way for me to see him, and basically just he himself had hit the ground, I hit him, I hit the brakes at the same time, but I hit him hard. And he bounced and skidded and ended up in the gutter with his head sort of bent next to the curb like this, not making a sound of movement, you know, just basically unplugged. And so I was terrified. I got out of the car, I ran over towards him, and just at that moment, you know, I was saying to myself, well, this is it, you know, this is with you know, after such a stroke of great luck to have been able to make my first album for Apple Records when everything looked so sunny and so good, it's all over, you know, this is it. I've killed someone with my car, and besides, I was holding drugs and works. And I'd just come from scoring. I was, once the police, you know, looked me over, I was finished, you know. I knew this. And there was no way I could drive away from it, you know. It's just the hit and run thing is impossible. Take it from me. I don't know. Anyway, so it was just sort of dawning on me that this was really a serious end to everything, including this poor bastard who I just run into. When a cop came from behind me and said, "Thank God you got him, sir. Thank God you hit him," you know. And I was sort of I was amazed. I said, "But I he can't be alive." I said, "We've been chasing that guy for about 10 blocks." And he was disheveled. I noticed that the guy actually had been wearing this policeman's helmet, which was also in the street, and he had been carrying that policeman's nightstick. He beat the policeman up, took his nightstick and his helmet, and he had gone down the Brompton Road, which was on the other side of Knightsbridge, breaking windows and singing a lilting Gaelic tune. And you know, right away, a radio car pulled up too with some senior police officers in it. You know, and I'm just like, oh Jesus, and I said, but what about this guy? They walked over to him. There was a van that pulled up. They walked over, and as they picked this guy up out of the street, he opened one eye and looked up at me like this, and he said, "You fucker." My luck's turned bad. That's great. You know, it was the, you know, there have been other close calls like that too. But that was a good one. That was a good one. Yeah.
This is going to be James' next Audible project, "Crimes I Got Away With." Well, I should let you get on to the real business of the evening, but we haven't talked too much about American Standard, which is a fantastic record, and quite amazing to hear you take those old tunes and make them sound like James Taylor songs. You've in some cases sort of even bent the melodies a little bit to accommodate your style. Were there any that surprised you when you went to work on them? These are tunes you heard as a kid.
Yeah.
Tunes you probably saw in Broadway shows with your parents and stuff.
There were a couple that we played in my band in 1966 in New York too.
Really?
Yeah. So these are all songs that I knew really well. The only one that I knew it completely, but it was John Pizzarelli who is my there are three producers. We're going to bring John out in a little bit, and he and I are going to try to debut a few of these old chestnuts for you. But John, he did make some suggestions, and that was one of his suggestions was you have to be carefully taught from South Pacific, which is it's a beautiful tune, and really surprising for its day. But no, there really were very few surprises because these are songs that I had listened to from my parents' record collection. They're sort of the I think what qualifies a standard is that it was sort of music that your parents listened to.
Which for many people would be James Taylor music at this point.
That may be true.
You've written a few standards.
True, but standards also refer to the Great American Songbook. And in my opinion, these songs, which I learned as a kid, and which as I was learning the guitar, I played, I arranged for the guitar, and would like just experiment with. So in a way, they taught me my music as well. So it's sort of a snake eating its tail, a little bit, because it informed my music as well as my musical sort of process informing what what American Standards versions of these are. So I knew them all as guitar tunes, and I wanted to I asked John Pizzarelli if he would sort of work with me and collaborate and help bring these arrangements that I had into shape, and if he would sort of support me musically, and we would cut them as demos. But it turned out that the demos were the actual finished product. They were the tracks, and it really was a wonderful thing to work with John. And you know, it's the thing that makes this different is that it's a guitar album.
Yeah, it sure is.
And there aren't any keyboards on it. There are no strings on it. We sort of took the tracks around to my community of players, my band that I travel with and work and record with, and we had Larry Goldings and Walt Fowler and Lou Marini, Steve Gadd and Luis Conte all added solos here or some percussion there. We took it down to Nashville and got Jerry Douglas, the brilliant dobro player, and Stuart Duncan, the master fiddle player, to contribute too. So it has a it's not a cookie cutter standards album, and ain't nothing wrong with that. That's fine to get a good rhythm section and a good arranger, put the song in your key, and then overdub your voice on it. That's
tried and true.
Tried and true, and it's beautiful. It makes some beautiful records. But this basically are these songs that I've known for my life, and that have been put through the James Taylor-matic, you know, kind of through the, yeah.
Well, I think the best thing I could do is get out of here and let you folks hear what James is talking about. But James, thank you very much.
Always,
always a pleasure.